Good morning and welcome to the fifth meeting in 2024 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. I remind all members and witnesses to ensure that their devices are on silent, and Marie McNair, MSP, will be joining us online. The first item on our agenda today is to decide whether to take items 4 and 5 in private. Are members agreed? That we're all agreed. The second item on our agenda today is to take evidence from the Housing Cladding Remediation Scotland Bill from Paul McClellan, who's the Minister for... Housing of the Scottish Government. And Mr McClellan is joined in the room by Kate Hall, who's the director from the Cladding Remediation Directorate, Rachel Sunderland, who's the Deputy Director of at the Cladding Remediation Directorate, and Michaela West, who is the legal is from the Legal Directorate of the Scottish Government. And I welcome our witnesses to the meeting. I'd like to invite the Minister to make a short opening statement before turning to questions from members.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the committee, and thank you for the opportunity to speak to you today on the important topic of the Housing Cladding Remediation Scotland Bill. The safety of homeowners and residents continues to be this government's absolute priority. The cladding remediation programme is a core element of our comprehensive response to the tragic fire that took place at Grenfell Tower. As the committee will be aware, we established a ministerial working group on mortgage lending and cladding, and a ministerial working group on building and fire safety following the tragedy, which included a wide range of stakeholders. Substantial progress has been made on key issues, with changes to fire safety standards and guidance, as well as legislation on smoke alarms. When I gave evidence to this committee on our cladding programme back in May, I noted that we were looking urgently at legislative options to address barriers to the delivery of the programme, to keep residents safe and hold developers to account. I am pleased to be back in front of the committee today, giving evidence on the Housing Cladding Remediation Scotland Bill. The bill builds on the work of both the Ministerial Working Group on Building and Fire Safety and the Ministerial Working Group on Mortgage Lending and Cladding that I mentioned. The direct experience of delivering the cladding remediation programme, feedback from partners and stakeholders, including residents, as well as our learning from cladding programmes in England and Wales, have also given a priority to my engagement with developers and residents, both individually and collectively. I'd also like to record my thanks to colleagues across the Chamber for engaging with me and my officials on behalf of their constituents. In furtherance of the bill, we are committed to further engagement on regulations, on guidance and on implementation. We will continue to listen and to engage. I recognise that there is a desire to increase the pace of delivery, and that is why we moved from a grant approach to a direct delivery model. I welcome the fact that 9 developers signed developer commitment letters and have agreed to identify and remediate their buildings, and that we are now working at a pace to agree a developer remediation contract. It is that need to address barriers to delivery and increase pace that underpins this legislation, and specifically the proposed powers to assess and remediate buildings where the consent of homeowners cannot be obtained. This committee has heard from witnesses agreeing that it would not be fair that willing homeowners are obstructed from mediation by others who are unwilling or are absent. The particular danger posed by cladding has necessitated bespoke powers relating to this issue, balanced by strong procedural safeguards to protect the interests of owners and residents. In drafting the bill, we were also mindful of the report produced by Dame Judith Hackett, Chair of the Independent Review of Building Reviews and Fire Safety. It is important that there is a source of information about these buildings within the scope of this bill. The cladding assurance register is therefore intended to reassure the public about those buildings that have been assessed and remediated under this programme. Clearly, responsibility is at the forefront of our minds here. Convener, we have included provisions in this bill to support developers who want to participate in remediation of buildings for which they are responsible. The proposed framework of the Responsible Developer Scheme preserves the position of those who accept the responsibility and ensures that they will not be at a commercial disadvantage because of their participation. Similarly, those eligible developers who decide not to participate should be appropriately sanctioned. Many developers in Scotland have already signalled their intention to mediate their buildings that they constructed or refurbished through the Scottish Safer Buildings Accord, and it is only right we prepare a level and consistent operational landscape for them. Accordingly, we are treating the public finances respectively by spreading the financial burden of remediation to those who are most directly responsible. Our focus as a government on the communities that we all serve means that this will be done in a fair and proportionate way without endangering the viability of participants in the sector that is so valuable to the economy of Scotland. In summary, this bill is designed to facilitate progress of the cladding remediation programme. It will allow for the creation of a cladding remediation register, which will provide information on buildings which have undergone a single building assessment and remediation. It will allow for the assessment of buildings through a single building assessment, even in cases where it is not possible to secure the consent of homeowners. The bill will also allow ministers to specify the standard for a single building assessment. The bill will also provide ministers with the power to arrange remediation work, where that work has already been identified in a single building assessment report, as well as being needed to eliminate or mitigate risks to human life that are directly or indirectly created or exacerbated by the building's external cladding system, even in cases where it is not possible to secure consent. The bill also includes provisions to establish a responsible developer scheme. I look forward to answering any questions that you may have, and as I said, I'm accompanied by my officials Kate Hall, Rachel Sunderland and Michaela West. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much for that opening statement, Minister. And as you'll be aware, we've had some very useful, constructive roundtable sessions on the bill. And as a result of that, we've got questions for you, of course. I'm going to start. I think my first question is around the scope of the bill, in a way. And what we've heard is that owners and residents living in buildings with potentially flammable cladding have raised an issue that the bill doesn't address the key issue facing them, and that's the lack of action to remediate fire risk in a timely manner. And I'd be interested to hear what reassurance you could offer that the bill will deliver speedy cladding remediation.
Thank you. It can be. I think a couple of things. I think for me, I've had mentioned in my opening speech, I've met with obviously developers, but met with the groups of residents on a regular basis, and that comes through as part of their concerns. I think when we go back to the actual scope, obviously it was, the main focus was on the external cladding. I think one of the key things and discussions we've had with developers and obviously the residents that are there is their overall fire safety within that. So obviously that's on their ongoing discussions with every building that we're involved in at that particular stage. There is a difference, I think, between fire safety, but also some issues around about, and we've had this picked up from residents around about, probably work around about, you know, if it's remediation around about, you know, if fire doors have been taken off, things like that, things that are, there's fire safety, but I think there are also things around about maintenance of fire programmes, for example, if fire doors have been removed. So I think we've tried to pick that up in individual discussions with that in terms of that. But in terms of the scope, it obviously focuses on the cladding itself, but as there are discussions, as I said, ongoing, where we have with the developers and residents around about the overall fire safety. In terms of that, there is the ministerial group on fire safety and so on, which obviously gets included as part of that. The cladding element in the buildings we're looking at, but also more extensively across the building network in Scotland.
Okay. Thanks for that. And again, in terms of the owners and residents and what we've heard, one of the key challenges that they face is the difficulty of obtaining insurance and in selling or remortgaging their property. And it's not clear from the evidence that we've heard that in responding to the challenges of cladding alone and not responding to the fire safety issues that this will precipitate a change in that situation. I'd be interested to hear what your thoughts are about that.
That's been frustrating, I have to say, in the process that we carried out. I think it was around about November, December time, I chaired an interministerial group. And obviously this is a reserve matter, so we obviously discussed that with UK Finance. That the Welsh Government, who had previously met, had the same concerns at that particular time. Officials have raised it on a number of occasions. I've raised it on a number of occasions with my opposite number, as I did in the interministerial group. One of the key things that we asked for and is in the process of being arranged was a working group with officials to try and move this progress along. And the discussions we had, the UK Government had basically said it was focusing first of all on England in terms of regulations around about where they do, and then they would hope to roll it out with that, out to the devolved administrations. So we needed to see a quickening of the pace. Now, we got that undertaking that would happen. But as I said, it's not within our control. Obviously, it's a reserve matter in terms of that. We're aware, obviously, of the issues that are caused. It's been raised by residents on a number of occasions. So the discussions are ongoing with officials on that to try and get to a solution that not only that obviously is for the UK government, but obviously Welsh government ourselves. And now that the Northern Ireland Executive has been reformed, I think they're obviously just starting the process, obviously, them as well. But it's frustrating at the moment about the pace it's doing that. It's out with our control, but we are continuing to push it whenever we meet with either ministers or officials in terms of that. I don't know if either Rachel or Kate want to bring up some of the discussions they've had lately, but certainly we're continuing to push that. But I don't know if there's been discussions in the last few weeks on the back of that.
I think the only thing I would add is that the Association of British Insurers are part of our cladding stakeholder group, that they've been closely involved all the way through the process. And certainly, for example, the register is something that we're talking to them very closely about, because that would... Part of that is about that being a mechanism to give them the information that they need in terms of buildings having been assessed and remediated, which should help the residents in terms of accessing financial products, including insurance. And we will continue to work with them once the bill goes through its process, and if that is passed, how we operationalise that in a way that works and addresses those concerns which are within our gift.
Okay. Convener, happy to write to the committee if there's any progress made on that, but we are continuing to push that on a regular basis.
Thank you, that would be very welcome. Yeah. And then my final question, again, from the kind of views of the owners and residents. They've raised concerns about poor communication from the Scottish Government regarding the cladding remediation, and especially about the single building assessment pilot project. And I'd be interested to hear what your thoughts are on that and what you want to, will put in place to improve that communication.
Again, in speaking to residents, that's something that's come up quite a bit. I just had a meeting with residents last week of a particular number of developments, and this was raised. And I think one of the key things is that there has been a large increase in numbers of the directorate that are working in the cladding area. So that's an area that I know we need to do a little bit more work on. We're looking at communication protocols around about that. I think communication is slightly different for each building and each developer and the factor that's kind of going. So there has to be that personalised approach, if you like, to the buildings. But communication needs to get better, as the directorate has grown over the last number of months as the bill approaches and as we're doing more work around about that. So there is that, and I acknowledge we need to do more work on that. But it needs to be personalised to the building itself. And I think one of the things I can say to residents, even if there's nothing to say, let's tell them there's nothing to say, there's work being carried out sort of stuff. So it's leaving that vacuum, I think, which is where they're concerned around about that. And as part of the pilot project, that's obviously something that we've picked up on. But it has been raised by residents, and I acknowledge that there could have been more done. But we are working on that just now in terms of that.
Great, thanks for that. So more resource directed towards this initiative, but also communicating more regularly, even if there's nothing to be said.
I mean, and the chats I've had with residents, they've said that themselves in terms of communication. Even if there is nothing to say in the next 6 months, even if it's just an update and say, look, 3 months later, we're working on this. We expect to be back to you in 3 months. Just that regular communication. And I said there's also a role of factors and the developers themselves as part of that. But it's developing that communication protocol, I think, is really important. And as I said, the focus when the directorate was set up was around about looking at the technical issues and working with developers and so on. Now there's more staff within the directorate. Communications is incredibly important as we step up the pace.
Sounds great that you have that awareness of that needing to take place. I'm going to bring in Mark Griffin.
I wonder if you're able to just set out why there was no public consultation when it came to developing the proposals in the bill.
I think one of the key things, obviously, was the immediacy of the bill. When I came back here, I think it was May, I originally came back and said that we were considering that at that particular time. I think if there had been the consultation process, which was normally 3 months, that would have taken us probably into towards the end of the year, obviously, in the back of summer recess. There was immediacy of moving towards that. We'd also had the ministerial working groups who had spoken to stakeholders over that period of time. I think one of the key things, I think, for me was that ongoing consultation moving forward. Now, in terms of meetings, I've had numerous meetings with Homes for Scotland where the individual developers have been present. I've also had a number of meetings with the individual developers, probably two or three each individually, to pick up their own individual concerns as well. And I think the important thing is, obviously, as well as liaising and working with the committee, but also working and speaking to residents. So I've tried to meet residents' groups on a number of occasions as well, sometimes two or three meetings we've had as well. So I think it was immediacy. The bill was the main thing to try and get us through, because, as I said, if we hadn't looked at the timetable, we probably would have been into the end of the year. But we needed, and I think for the reasons we've outlined in the bill, this gives us the power to move and quicken the pace around about the programme itself. So that was the main reason for that. And again, I've tried to be as open and transparent with all the stakeholders in terms of that on a number of occasions, and we'll continue to do so until the bill passes and after.
Thanks. I appreciate the need for urgency on this in particular. Is there anything that's been picked up after the bill's been proposed through the evidence sessions with committee that potentially would have been gathered through the public consultation that you're now reflecting on?
I talked about communication, and again, I think that was important. I think there's obviously technical aspects of the bill, and one of the key things, I think, for me, and I'll maybe bring Kate and Rachel in as well in some of the discussions they've had. Some of the important things, I think, for me was talking around about the technical specifications, around about, you know, as we move forward, and around about the SBA process. And this is where the individual discussions with the developers themselves have been really important in terms of how we move towards that. We're taking a similar approach to England and Wales now. The tenure system in Scotland is slightly different as it is in England and Wales, so we needed to take a nuanced approach to that. Now, that may have picked up some issues that were in terms of that. So again, having these individual discussions with the stakeholders around about the technical issues may have been picked up in terms of that. But again, you know, we've listened to what stakeholders are telling us around about that, and I'm sure there'll be questions around about that. But the key thing was listening to them, and I think when I went into the process, not having the consultation, I was really keen to make sure I consulted personally with stakeholders as much as we possibly could. And I know colleagues and officials have been doing that on a regular basis as well. And I'll continue to do that as the bill progresses. And you know, developers may or may not have said it. I've always said it's an open-door process. So if a developer needs to come and speak to me or our residents, I'm more than happy to pick that up. But I think that it was really back to the immediacy, trying to get the legislation through to quicken the pace of what we're trying to do.
OK, thanks for that. You know, we've had a range of views throughout the course of the evidence sessions, and some witnesses have raised concerns about the broad scope of the bill and how that could potentially impact the speed and cost of assessment and remediation. But similarly, you know, other witnesses have said that the bill doesn't go far enough, that they would look for the bill to cover essentially all fire safety aspects of the building rather than just cladding. So just wonder what the Minister and what Government's thinking is between those balances of argument, and whether it's potential to essentially have a prioritisation based on risk of multiple fire safety issues.
I think obviously one of the key things was establishing the scope of the programme, obviously after Grenfell. And I think there was discussions obviously before I came into post and before the scheme started to develop around about that, and obviously it was around about the cladding issue itself. Developers have raised the fire issue and that overall broader fire issue in terms of that, and I'll maybe bring in colleagues in a wee second to talk around about some of the discussions we've had around about that. And I know Mr Briggs has mentioned before around about the scope, when I was on committee as well, mentioned about the scope and how far that goes. And I suppose it's a balance around how quick would the legislation need to get through, where is the biggest risk in terms of that. So obviously I've read the previous sessions in terms of that, and there is a mix of views, as you said. So, and having these individual discussions with developers and with the residents as well, you know, they've raised issues. It's not just around about the cladding, it's overall fire safety in terms of that. So there are discussions ongoing just now with developers and residents in terms of, but I'm confident in about the scope we've got just now. It's sufficient to allow us to move on. But I don't know if Rachel or Kate want to come in around about the discussions we've had around about the fire issue.
I mean, in terms of scope, it may be helpful. Obviously, there's a cladding remediation programme in Scotland, there's a cladding remediation programme in England, there's a cladding remediation programme in Wales, and there is a similarity of alignment in terms of the scope, in terms of the size of the buildings, 11 metres and above, in terms of the kind of the time period that we're looking at. So there is a similarity there. There are clearly, as we've seen with things like RAC and other issues, there are other issues that are kind of going on in terms of building safety. But I think in terms of the focus of this particular programme being quite tightly focused on cladding remediation and the scope of the programme seeking to reflect that, I think it's always going to be a balance about how broad and how narrow it is. We've tried to have that alignment so that we link up with the programmes in England and Wales, and there's a certain similarity there in terms of what we're all trying to do.
Yeah, and I think, you know, as I said, the key thing is discussions are ongoing. That there's existing legislation, obviously, around about fire safety, and I suppose it kind of, how do we then, you know, how is it fitting together with obviously the cladding issue in terms of that. So there are obviously discussions. I mean, we are speaking to residents and, as I said, developers, that this issue comes up. And there is, I think I mentioned to the convener around about Is there an issue around about fire building safety maintenance and the actual fire building safety itself? There's a difference in terms of that. So if there's things not being maintained, I think that's slightly different from, you know, the issues that are around about fire safety. So that's been picked up. But that's kind of picked up the existing legislation. But as I said, and as Rachel said, we're following the same outlook that both the England and Welsh governments are doing. And I think the Northern Irish government are just starting the process, and they've already been in touch, I think, with ourselves to discuss where that kind of is already fitted in. So we're following very much the scope that was carried out by the UK and Welsh governments.
OK, thank you.
Thanks, Mark. Just before I bring in Pam Gosol, I just want to go back to Mark's previous question around the public consultation, and you mentioned that you have had extensive meetings with various stakeholders, but I didn't hear you mention fire safety experts or the surveyors, or the people that will need to deliver the work on the ground, and I wondered if you have had meetings with them.
Not myself. I know colleagues have who've brought in, because obviously it becomes an element of technical knowledge, which I have a little. But in terms of actual fire safety and the actual technical knowledge, there's been discussions that have been held and obviously fed back to myself. So again, I don't know if Kate or Rachel want to come in that, but there have been extensive discussions with that sector as well.
I think the only thing I would add is obviously that the proposals and the bill come out of quite a long history of engagement. So we've got the Ministerial Working Group on Fire Safety, the Ministerial Working Group on Mortgages and Cladding, and then we've got the stakeholder group, so Association of British Insurers, of kind of fire engineers. There's been a kind of a history of engagement, and also it's come out of the learning that we've had from the programme itself, where there's been quite extensive engagement with fire engineers and experts, and also the feedback from developers. So whilst there hasn't been that formal period of consultation, there's been quite a lot of engagement, and certain elements such as the previous Scottish Advice Note, there was public consultation on that. There was quite a lot of engagement around different elements. So I guess it is a reflection of all those different bits of engagement, including with experts.
I would also add that, obviously, as part of the work that we're doing on the SPA specification, we have technical experts that are contracted to us to support that, and we also have technical expertise within the Directorate as part of our wider skills mix. So we are actively engaging all the time to ensure that we've covered all the technical bases fully and completely. Thank you.
I mean, I think it's safe to say as well, in terms of the discussions we've had about the roundtables, which Homes Scotland are arranging also with individual developers themselves, what we tend to see is there's a mix probably from the developers around about probably the managing directors or finance directors, as well as the technical people that need to be in the room to talk about that. So there have been discussions, and obviously in terms of what we have, there's technical people in the room in terms of that and policy. So that's discussed at roundtables, it's discussed at the individual discussions as well. So it's quite well covered off in that regard.
Thanks very much. That certainly is reassuring. I'm now going to bring in Pam Gosol.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. The concept of single building assessment is central to this cladding remediation bill, and yet each week witnesses have told us that there is a lack of specification and guidance on the SBAs. What they look like, its specification, what standards it is assessing to. As stated by Phil Diamond from Diamond & Company, chartered professionals desperately need something to benchmark so that everyone is working from the same standards and singing from the same hymn sheet. Does the Scottish Government intend to clearly define the scope of the single building assessment and standards as assessing, and if so, when?
Yes, and I thank you for that question. Again, having the discussions with Homes for Scotland and the individual developers, this is obviously brought up as the main issue in terms of, and I'll bring officials in a little second regarding the technical discussions they've had. So I think when I came in the role, there was a number of key objectives I had. One was getting a developer commitment letter to making sure that, you know, they were signed into what we're trying to do, and I undertook a process of speaking to individual developers at that stage. That was raised, so we got the letter designed. The next stage was obviously moving into the long-form contract in terms of that. Now, the issue that came in around about that was about the SBA. When the SBA process was raised, I asked officials to get a task and finish group, which has been undergoing for a number of months, in terms of that, to get down to the specific specifications. So we done that. Now, Homes for Scotland were present at that meeting. We then had individual discussions and roundtable discussions, and there's been a number of roundtables as we move towards that. The tenure system in Scotland is obviously slightly different Obviously, there was the SAN, there was a Scottish Advice note that was there in terms of that, but we talked around about the PAS, moving towards the PAS, and the technical specifications around about that. Having the individual discussions with the developers as well. The SBA, again, will pick up different things in different buildings. It depends on where the developers are, and we've tried to work very closely individually with these people around about that, but we do need that specification. Both for the safety of residents that are there, and we're satisfied with the technical specifications that come forward, which is incredibly important. But the key thing, I think, for me, having an individual discussion, was listening to what we had back. And I've visited a number of buildings as well, in terms of not just hearing from them, but actually going out and saying, look, this is what we're looking at, this is what we're doing, this is what the clarity that we need. On that, and I think that was a key thing, I think, for me. So that's been a priority all the way through, I think, in terms of making progress, and I don't think we're far away from getting that agreement with all the developers in terms of that. I think that's probably been the thing that's slowed down progress, but I think it's the most important thing to make sure that we're happy with the specifications and the developers themselves are happy with the specifications. Most importantly, even though the residents might not know the technical specifications, that they've got belief in the system, both through ourselves and the developers. So it's been a focus for me all the way through. It will continue to be a focus in the discussions we've had with individual developers. But I'll maybe bring Rachel or Kate in again in terms of where we are just now. I know there's been really good progress made on that, and I think, I think within a short period of time we'll have that agreement and be able to move forward. But it's important that we have that in place. And we have that, but I don't know if Rachel wants to come in and just say a little bit more around about that.
The only thing I would say is that obviously the bill provides for the Scottish Government to be able to produce guidance on what a single building assessment is. So it is specifically within the bill allowing ministers to put that level of detail that people are asking for into guidance. But I know Kate will want to.
So we have got a contractor working for us at the moment who is working on a technical specification for the SBA. And as the Minister has said, we've been listening to developers and our own technical experts in developing that. That work is ongoing at the moment, but we would hope by the spring that we will have a final draft on that, obviously to provide certainty to developers and others. Obviously, until the bill has completed its passage, it obviously cannot be an SBA under the terms of the bill. But we would hope that the technical specification that we work on at the moment would then provide the basis for that to continue in the future. So, thank you.
Convener, just to remember, I suppose the key thing, I think, for me right at the start was having that open and transparent discussions with the developers. And I've said that all along to them, it's an open door, please come back to us. And even though within, we could go out and set the specification on our own sort of thing, it was important that we had that agreement and do that. Because again, the cladding is one issue, but obviously in the line of work I meet the developers on a regular basis. Cladding is obviously raised, other issues are obviously raised, but it was very much for me an inclusive process, and that's why we've tried to listen to them as much as we possibly could, why we set up the task and finish group in terms of that as well. And so I think that was really important, and that will continue, but I don't think we're far away in terms of getting that, which will quicken the progress about where we're going with this.
No, thank you for that, Minister. But it's obviously very, very encouraging to hear that you have a task and finish group and that you're involving good consultation. But industry probably would like to hear when, because obviously there are a lot of questions around this that, what, like I said, what hymn sheet are they singing to? So I know that you mentioned spring, Kate. What are you looking at roughly? Because obviously, already there's a lot of delays in the cladding situation. So that what is it that industry can take from this committee today to say that, there's an assurity that you will be in the next, 4 months, 5 months, bringing the definitions out?
I'll let Kate come in and then I'll come back in myself on that one. So.
Thank you, Minister. So the developers are actually actively involved in this process, so they will have transparency about where we are in terms of the development of that technical specification. As I say, I would hope that by Easter we would have a final draft of that specification. Obviously, it cannot be, as I say, an SBA under the bill until the bill is passed, but we would hope that that technical specification that we reach by that point would be the one that we could then move forward with under the terms of the bill once the bill has completed its passage through Parliament.
It's secondary legislation there, Kate? Or was it guidance?
The bill is designed to provide guidance to set out the SBA in the future, so it doesn't require secondary legislation under the current terms of the bill in order to put that in out as part of the subsequent arrangements in relation to the bill.
Yeah. And coming back just to your point, I suppose all it was in terms of that is how involved they are in terms of discussions. And this is obviously the technical people from each of the companies that are involved, who have been incredibly helpful through the process. When it comes down to the actual technicalities, then obviously we'll leave that to the people who have got the expertise. But it's fed back to me on a regular basis on the progress of this. And I think, as Kate said, I'm pretty confident by springtime we'll have this agreed. And I think, you know, we listen to what they said when we're talking about the PAS standards and what else is there. As I said, it's slightly different. It's not just a pick up and move from the UK government, because there are slight differences in terms of tenure system and whatever. But we've tried to work as closely as we possibly can with them, and they are still part of the task and finish group in terms of that. So obviously that's fed back into Homes for Scotland more generally, but the individual discussions at the end about some of the buildings again are sometimes, you know, more individual, because they are slightly different buildings that come in that. So we're trying to listen. But having that, I agree, having that overall process and agreement in place is incredibly important. Once we have that, I think the pace will move on a lot quicker. So that's a key priority for myself and officials to move on.
Thank you, Minister. I have one more question. The committee has heard calls for the Scottish Government to adopt PAS 9980 as the basis of the single building assessment process. It's popular among professionals, offers the more flexibility for professional judgment, and is widely used by professionals across the United Kingdom. With a bit of modification to fit legal aspects and such, Phil Diamond believes that PAS would be the way to go. Gary Strong from Royal Institution of Chartered Surveyors also pointed out a fire is a fire and a building's a building, wherever it is geographically. And broadly, witnesses seem to agree that there is merit in harmonising standards where possible. So can I ask you, how do you respond to the calls to adopt PAS 9980 and harmonise these different standards?
Yeah, and again, I think part of the discussions we had in speaking to developers was around about PAS being raised on a certain number of occasions. And I know the two people who gave evidence haven't been involved in discussions as such. Obviously, we consult with the sector more broadly, but in terms of the developers, that's where the focus has been on the task and finish group to try and do that. And I'll probably bring in Rachel in terms of the discussions that have been held on the technical kind of issues in terms of that. But we did listen to what the sector had told us through the developers round table and the individual discussions we've had. Now, as I say, the system isn't just a pick up and shift from the UK government, because the tenure systems and there are different, slightly different building regulations. So I suppose part of where we are just now is taking on some of the feedback we've had from them, but actually going into the technical specifics around about the specification itself in terms of what does that look like. And I think, as Kate said, you know, we're not too far away from getting that agreement and moving on. But Rachel, I don't know if you want to add anything, or Kate, add anything on that one.
Yeah, so absolutely, PAS 9980 is the focus of a lot of our discussions at the moment in terms of how that could apply in Scotland, taking into account the tenure system, different arrangements in relation to the wider fire safety regime in Scotland, and that is the focus of our discussions at this phase. So we absolutely have been listening to that. That was part of the discussions in the Task and Finish Group last November, December, and we were hearing, obviously, from developers about the benefits of a certain degree of harmonisation where that was possible throughout the UK, and that's also would be supporting in terms of the wider supply chain for those people that would also be carrying out SBAs. So obviously still some further work to do on it, but PAS 9980 is certainly at the focus of our discussions in relation to that technical specification at the moment.
And again, convener, happy to write back to the committee in terms of, you know, when we get an agreement reached, just to keep you up to date on that.
Thanks very much for that. Continuing on the single building assessment track, I'm going to bring in Stephanie Callaghan.
Thanks very much, convener, and thanks for coming along, Minister, this morning, and everyone else too, of course. There have been some issues with the binary pass-fail process in single building assessment, and certainly some learning from PAS 9980 about intermediate levels of risk. We heard particular concerns from across all the sectors that this could lead to buildings which are not actually dangerous to life failing the assessment. So I'm wondering what your response is to calls for the single building assessment to recognise a tolerable or a medium risk.
I'll bring officials in that in a wee second. Generally speaking, you know, the fire safety, the safety, the cladding issue safety is the most important thing. And when it comes back to individual buildings, there have obviously been issues that, probably within, I know within the first week I was in the job, there were specific concerns about one specific building, where tough decisions had to be made around about that. I'm not going to name the building, but that was within a day or two of that. You know, there were specific issues in and about issues straight away that were causing real concern to us. So there were a couple of buildings that were like that, where decisions have had to be made to negate the risk very quickly in terms of that. In terms of the binary pass or fail sort of thing, I think getting down to the level of details that we're talking about, I think having that agreement in place around about the specification, I think is really important. And I suppose some of the evidence in terms of that, obviously, is maybe not aware of the discussions we've been having with developers in terms of what that kind of looks like. And I think that's a level of detail that we're down to, because it's not just in terms of the specifications going forward in terms of that, it's in terms of where we are just now. So there is always discussions going on with the developers in terms of individual buildings that are going through the system as we speak. So that's always kind of looked at. But again, Kate or Rachel might come in that to talk around about some of the technical discussions that have been had about that. But it's an issue that's always the forefront of our minds in terms of, you know, as the work's getting carried out, or we move towards the work getting carried out, is the building safe? What's the standard that's there? If there are specific risks, which there have been in some buildings, we've taken action in terms of that to negate the risks. Now, part of the discussion right at the start of the statement I made was around about giving us the powers to do that. At the moment, we need to negotiate with developers, with local authorities, to allow us to do that. When the bill comes through, that will allow us to carry out immediate work if it's required at that particular stage. But we have had issues around about negotiating with other stakeholders about negating some of that immediate risk that's been there. And I've seen a couple of examples, as I said, straight away. But I remember in Kate, in terms of coming back to the tolerable standard and what's been kind of fed back. But it's at the forefront of our minds all the time on that.
Thanks, Minister. And yes, as I say, those technical discussions are still ongoing at the moment, but we've obviously been listening very carefully to both the evidence that's been presented to the committee and to our technical experts as well. So very happy to provide a further update once that work is a little bit more progressed. But at this point, obviously, we haven't finalised the arrangements for the specification, and that is continuing. But obviously noting that these are some of the considerations that we need to take into account as we move through that process.
And I'm just wondering, is there any kind of timeline then that you're looking at that you're expecting to have a firmer idea then around tolerable risk?
So I don't think we've taken a decision yet in terms of what the final risk level will be that we will finalise as part of that process, but obviously that work is still ongoing, and we will obviously come back to the committee as soon as that's finished.
And I think the key thing to take back on that, obviously I've had discussions around the table of individual developers. I think the key thing is it's working with the developers in terms of that, because it's not in their interest, obviously, to have a tolerable risk in any of their buildings that have come through. I mean, we've seen what we think is a risk that's an immediate danger or high danger. Then we've moved on that very quickly. In terms of the discussions that are still going on, yes, we're talking about the specifications in the SBA, but these are part of the wider discussions. We've had that, and I think Kate obviously talked around about, you know, looking to get to agreement towards the SBA in terms of April time. Easter, I think, is end of March, so we're talking around about that time. So I think that, you know, these discussions have been part of the round. So I think having the SBA process and moving on and agreed, I think, would allow us to move and set, you know, where the tolerable standards are. But these discussions are ongoing on a daily basis, and obviously risk is assessed on a daily basis. If there are any issues, we've dealt very quickly with them when we've needed to. And that's in conjunction with the developers themselves, other stakeholders, that we need to get to negotiate with, you know, can sometimes be an issue in terms of that. The legislation that will come into force will give us the powers to do that without having to negotiate and negate that risk as quickly as we possibly can.
Thanks.
But that's been assessed every building been in terms of that every day.
Okay. Thanks, Stephanie. Can I just come back in there on that a little bit? So one of the things that we heard, so there's the bit about tolerable risk, but what we heard is that at the moment there's a kind of pass-fail approach, and what people are calling for, experts and others are calling for, is a more nuanced approach. That at the moment you have a building that could just end up being in a kind of high risk category, but actually there's more nuance in there, and that what's needed is something that has that amber bit. That's how people have been referring to it. So just can you talk to that a little bit?
I'll bring Kate in on that. As I said, you know, there are discussions ongoing every day around about building safety, because as we move towards mediation, there's obviously that element in between the SBA process and moving towards actual remediation, and obviously that assessment goes on, you know, are there immediate risks, where does that kind of sit? And again, that's different for every developer, it's different for a very specific building, it's in terms of that. But I don't know if Kate or Rachel want to come in on that specific point. I know that's been raised with ourselves as well, in terms of that, by developers.
Yes, absolutely. That is absolutely part of the consideration that we're giving at the moment. And yes, we have heard the discussions about how that nuancing could assist in terms of the overall process. But we need to balance that against ensuring that we do meet the objectives of the programme, which is obviously to ensure that where there is direct or indirect risks to life that are exacerbated by the cladding, that we are then able to resolve those matters and make the buildings safer. And I think obviously the question of tolerable risk rather than a sort of yes or no category is something that we're definitely looking at and very much alive to as part of the discussions that we've got with our technical experts and obviously with developers, and clearly giving consideration to the safety and protection of homeowners as part of this as well.
Okay, great. Thanks for covering that a bit more detail. I'm now going to bring in Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning, Minister and colleagues. A couple of questions, Paul, on the cladding assurance register, if I may, and one on issues raised by the Law Society. Firstly, on the cladding assurance register, is it the government's intention that this is a one-off snapshot register and it won't change? Or do we plan to regularly update it if and when changes might be made to a building? And if it's the latter, do we need a statutory process to make sure that it's only responsible persons that can update that register? So if you could maybe describe the government's thinking in that area firstly, thank you.
Yeah, I'll bring in Michaela in terms of the legal aspect of it. I think one of the key things, again, this is there's a number of reasons, obviously, if we're talking about the cladding assurance register. One is obviously in terms of the residents themselves. I think that's the most important point. If they know their building's on the cladding assurance register, it gives them a little bit more comfort in terms of that. In terms of the developer themselves, I think it's important that they know the buildings on there, and governments recognise that. I think as part of the pilot project, obviously we have discussions with them and how do we then move forward in that. I think it's an iterative process. And if once it goes on, we need to make sure if, when buildings go through that it goes on to the register in terms of that. And again, we kind of talked around about some of the discussions we've had around about insurance and mortgages. And that in itself, I think, is a step forward. There's more technical, but I think if it moves towards that, I think it's almost a process in terms of saying to lenders and insurers, that's on a cladding assurance register. So I think that's incredibly important as part of the legislation that we're working. So for me, it's very much an iterative process. And I'll bring in Michaela in terms of any legal points that you kind of touched on in terms of that, about how that then looks like on a legal basis kind of going forward, or if Michaela wants to add anything on that.
Yeah, sure. So Section 1 of the bill lays out that the cladding assurance register, the information within it includes when a single building assessment was carried out in relation to a building, the works that the single building assessment report identified as being needed to eliminate risk to human life, and the date on which the Scottish ministers were satisfied that work had been completed. And so within that, the Scottish ministers have sort of overall responsibility for identifying whether those works are completed to that the level that they are satisfied that the work has been carried out or not. I don't know if anybody, if Rachel or Kate has anything to add to that.
I think it's probably fair to say that almost the cladding assurance register becomes the exit point for buildings that are on the programme. So if the single building assessment is the start of the process, then the cladding assurance is the exit point of the process, because what that does is it says this building has been through a single building assessment, the issues that have been identified which relate to that risk to life have been remediated, that therefore and therefore they have been addressed. So I don't think we would expect a building to come back round through that process again. I think we would expect that to be, it's been identified, it's been assessed, it's been remediated. It now would, you know, it's on that. So if there is an issue raised by a mortgage provider or an insurance provider, this building looks like it's got cladding, how confident are we about that cladding? They would be able to look at that and they would have confidence that that had been assessed and any issues had been remediated. So that's the purpose of the cladding assurance register. if that's helpful.
What if a building was subsequently modified, changed or otherwise, and the registration took place years before that? What happens then?
Well, I think it's probably fair to say that if there was any further cladding put on that building, it would obviously then fall into the kind of new legislation in terms of the types of cladding that would be able to be put on it. So it shouldn't then represent a fire safety risk linked to the cladding in the same way that historical cladding could represent a fire safety risk, because obviously the legislation has now changed in terms of being very prescriptive about the types of cladding which any developer would be able to put onto a building.
And just on that, again, Mr. Colbert, I think one of the important things I think for developers as well is engaging in terms of future standards going forward. And I think that obviously going through the process, are they reviewing their own processes? Probably not to say as much as that, but in terms of any other buildings that come forward, you know, there's probably more care taken in terms of that. And we know that they're aware of the ongoing maintenance of the buildings. It's not just a case of coming in and replacing the cladding and so on. It's that ongoing. So, you know, they've been aware of that issue going forward as well. So,
okay. The other question on the cladding assurance register, Paul, was the timing of when the entry is made on the register. You're probably aware that some of our colleagues given evidence asked for this to be as early as possible. For example, when remediation works have been identified and planned for, could that building then be put on the register to give owners, lenders, buyers and all that the assurance that it's on the register? Is that something that we would support, or would we insist on waiting for the work to be done before a building is put on the register?
I'll bring in Kate and Rachel on that specific point. Again, this has been raised by developers. I think once we get through, and I think at the moment we talked about the SBA process, and in terms of what does that kind of look like and when does it go on the register, and when do we make sure that the work's carried out, again, because that's been picked up by residents, is when do we make sure the work's carried out? Because part of the issue is you could go through, hypothetically, get a developer signing the development commitment letter, signing the contract itself, but if they don't carry out the work, and part of the issues around about legislation as well, and one of the key points is making sure if a company doesn't carry it out, then there are sanctions available to ourselves in terms of that, which may result in them not being able to develop in Scotland. Now, that's the ultimate, and I don't think we would get there, but obviously that's there. In terms of the actual timing, Kate, Rachel, I don't know if you want to come in on that one.
I read the evidence sessions on that, and I understand some of the drivers around that. However, I think from our perspective, there's also a fundamental kind of safety issue here. There's a reason that we don't name the buildings that are on the programme, and that is because there's a potential fire safety risk for the residents in there, and that follows engagement and discussion with SFRS, that there's a risk that if we say publicly, this building, there is a risk of fire safety there. Unfortunately, we know that there are, just talking to a resident of a building a couple of weeks ago, they'd had a potential arson, fire starting incident in there. So we need to be really careful about that. So I think we would be really wary about putting on the register buildings where risks had been identified but not yet remediated, because we're putting that information out into as kind of semi-public domain, which potentially raises risks for the residents there. So we need to balance those considerations really carefully as to at what point we put information out in terms of the fact that there's a fire safety risk. So our preference would be we identify the fire safety risk, we remediate the fire safety risk, and at that point there's information which is available that says there was an issue here, but it is now resolved. So there's no risk to the residents of those buildings by having that information in a wider circulation.
I suppose there's two things. One, obviously, I mentioned about the SB process, and I would understand there'd be a degree of frustration to get the buildings onto the register because it moves things forward for residents, for developers, for insurance and so on. So I think that's obviously, once we get through the SB process, I think that's important because then we can start getting remediation done and they can get onto the register. I think on its most basic forms, I suppose it's getting to a building that's just been built and it's not got its building safety certificate, and it gets to that level. When is the building safe? And it's when it's signed off, I think, is the key thing. But again, we've had with developers is how quickly can we move through that process to make sure it gets onto the register, right? And again, I said it gives reassurance to developers, to residents, and also talking about the issues that we face around about insurance and remortgaging and selling buildings and so on. So, but again, that's raised quite often by developers, and we're working on with them to try and get that through that process as quickly as possible.
Okay, that's clear enough. The Law Society, as you probably also heard, raised some issues about clarity of definition of terms throughout the bill, and they gave a number of examples, Paul, about where they felt there could be scope for misinterpretation. Here they mentioned what does otherwise undergone development mean, and they raised some other issues as well about defining risk, comparing it to risk to human life. So they gave a whole host of examples, Paul, of where some of the definitions might lack a little bit of clarity. Do you ask, is the government aware of that, and are we looking at trying to define, sharpen up, polish whatever the terminology that the bill will contain to assist everyone?
What had come through in terms of that, and I'll bring Michaela in a wee second, obviously, you know, we're listening to the concerns that have come forward, you know, as we move towards the actual bill itself. I think obviously we'll be looking at about how we can make sure that any issues that they raise are addressed in terms of that. So, Michaela, do you want to come in on that particular point that the Law Society made on?
Yeah, sure. So obviously there were a number of definitions that were identified from the Law Society. I think in particular the single building assessment will be defined or will be outlined in accordance with standards that are specified by ministers, and then in the single building assessment there will be scope to go into risk to human life that's being identified in a little bit more detail, the way that the definition of a building operates in the single building assessment, which includes that language undergone development, so that will create more detail in relation to those definitions, and we're taking into account the other comments they had to see if there's anything we do think needs to be sharpened up.
One of their other helpful suggestions, Paul, was would the government consider determining if there's some buildings that can be deemed out with the scope of the SBA process itself, that are of no risk whatsoever, because that would aid purchasers, buyers, mortgage lenders and so on and so forth to take a building and sell it, buy it, etc. But they felt that if that, without that, then that could delay those types of processes for buildings that are essentially safe.
And again, I think that's a good question. In terms of discussions we've had with developers, there is that issue around about them identifying the building, you know, in terms of identifying the buildings they think are in scope, but they've also identified buildings they think that aren't in scope. So there's almost that balance in terms of, right, the buildings that are in scope, let's try and, you know, get through the SBA process, let's get the remediation going through that. In terms of it being out of scope, I think that's incredibly important, because until we say that, and then residents who live in buildings who think they may or may not be in scope, I think it gives that reassurance in terms of that. So that's been raised. Rachel Kitt, I don't know if you want to add anything on that, but it has certainly been raised by Homes for Scotland and developers in terms of that. And it's a balance around about how we move towards making sure the buildings are safe that are in scope, but also giving the reassurances to developers and residents, to those who aren't, and give them that sense of relief, if you like. But for Rachel or Kate, want to come in?
I mean, Kate may want to add something, but I think there's a couple of different layers to this. One is there's obviously the scope as set out in the bill, and actually really clearly setting out the scope of the programme is, I think, helpful in the first instance in saying, actually, it's over this kind of height, it's this. That, I think, will be helpful for making clear, actually, we're not talking about these buildings over here. So I think that would be helpful. I think there's buildings which potentially fall within scope, but actually if you once you do a kind of maybe a light touch assessment, you can see that actually they don't really need any work done to them. So I think there's that needs to be done. They still need to go through some kind of an assessment, but actually you might find just because a building is assessed, it might not mean that you necessarily find things that need to be done. And actually the bill allows for, you could do a single building assessment and actually find out that there is nothing that needs to be remediated. And that building could then very quickly, kind of straight away, go onto the register. I think there is a challenge in the register seeking to include everything which is potentially out of scope, because that then becomes, almost appears to negate the process, because actually the other thing is, we won't have assessed those buildings, so we won't know if there are other things which are not to do with cladding, but are other things which actually might might be issues in relation to that building, because we're not looking for them. So I think there are things that we can do about clarifying the scope really clearly, and there are things that we can do about if we do a single building assessment and actually it's fine, it goes straight on, and how quickly we can get through remediation. But we also need to be really clear about what the purpose of the cladding assurance register is, and it's not about providing assurance to the broader sector about safety of buildings.
But if they don't, if those types of buildings don't go on the cladding assurance register, where do they go? Where would the public get that information?
So I think that is a kind of a broader issue, which I know is being worked through in terms of building safety colleagues, because obviously there are a broader set of issues around building safety, which I know that colleagues are working through on the back of some of the things around RAC and other issues, but which are not necessarily cladding assurance issues. But it's a very important issue, but not... It's not the purpose of this particular register, but happy to, we can pass that back to colleagues if that would be helpful.
Okay, that's good that that's in consideration by the government. We'll have to deal with that in some way. Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks, Willie. I'm now going to bring in Stephanie Callaghan again.
Back again. So in evidence, we've heard calls for more detail on the face of the bill and the responsible developer scheme. But there has been a real debate around this as well, with some saying the bill's too broad and relies too much on the secondary legislation, which could come too slowly, while others are stating the bill's too narrow, that it should be the framework bill with secondary legislation following quickly. So I'm just wondering what your reflections are on this, Minister, and what your response is. And also, might draft secondary legislation be available during parliamentary consideration of the bill?
I'll probably bring Michaela in on that. And I think you're right. I mean, part of the coming back probably to the broader context about the responsible developer scheme, obviously that's following the model in England, in Wales, in terms of, I think that's a really important part of the legislation for me, kind of going ahead. And obviously the developers, the first stage of that was obviously talking then about the commitment letter, which I think, you know, was almost them public coming out and saying, look, we're working with you on that one. The mediation contract itself, I think, is another step in terms of that. The responsible developer scheme then gives us the powers to, you know, if we're talking about, you know, in terms of if the work doesn't get carried out, which I think is really important, because it does then give us the ability to look at the sanctions. As I said, we haven't had any issues in terms of developers coming and speaking to us, and I've had individual discussions. I'm not getting anything from individual discussions from developers saying we don't want to be part of this. You know, they've all been really keen to sit down and engage and be very conducive with us and very much working with us in terms of that. So, you know, I think it's important to give that context. They've all been very supportive in working with us because they know what they need to do for, first of all, most importantly, the residents. But obviously in terms of their own, I suppose, their own outlook in terms of what they need to do. And there is that reputational risk as well if they don't carry out the work. The responsible developer scheme does give us that sign and gives us powers to do that. In terms of the legislation issue, I'll maybe bring Michaela in terms of what's been raised in terms of that. But in terms of overall, I think that's the important thing. But as I said, part of the consultation discussions we've had with them is trying to almost... I'm not saying tease out, but almost trying to look at, you know, what is the attitude of the development, the sector itself. And I have to say they've been very, 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 very helpful, working very closely with ourselves in terms of that. And they want to move as quickly as they possibly can as well. But in terms of the points you moved about legislation, Michaela, I don't know if you want to come in on that.
Yep. So the responsible developer scheme section in the bill is obviously a framework power to take to allow ministers to create regulations and affirmative regulations specifically, which would be brought back to be considered by this committee. I don't know if Kate or Rachel want to come in.
I think there's probably a couple of things. I think there's you've raised the point about how do you get the balance right between what you put in primary and secondary legislation, and there will be differing views about that. What we've tried to do in the primary legislation is set out the types of things that will be included in the secondary legislation to give the committee a sense of where we're going. As Michaela said, we will be bringing that detail back through affirmative regulations. I think what I would say is we've also kind of looked at the approach in England and learnt from that a little bit in terms of they did the kind of primary framework legislation, then they did the regulations. It also, with the regulations, it allows us to link it to the ongoing discussions we're having in terms of the developer remediation contract, because actually what we agree in the developer remediation contract, we would expect to see very close alignment between that and the regulations. And also, it allows us to put a level of detail in the regulations that we wouldn't normally expect to see in primary legislation, and allows us to reflect back to some of the other kind of moving parts around this that we've already talked about to give that degree of certainty, hopefully.
Coming back to the point you made, again, a lot of this process has been reflective in terms of that, you know, when we've brought the legislation forward, but actually just going through the discussions, it is reflecting very closely, and it does, you know, right at the outset, for me, it was very much a partnership approach. It can't be just government going in and saying we need this, this, and this. Of course, there's that element of, you know, we negate the risk, and that's the most important part. But more generally speaking, it's been that reflective and making sure it's as much a partnership as possible. Can you go through? And again, happy to, you know, when we more discussions, happy to write back to the convener in terms of how that progresses as well as the bill process continues.
So it's certainly good to hear you highlighting that around the developers as well in the first instance too. And I know there have been issues about actually, you know, them having to look to make changes to primary legislation in England as well, and obviously we don't want to be in that position there.
Just on that point again, yep. Officials, and you know, I've met meetings at ministerial level in terms of officials discussing that. I mean, obviously, officials discuss on a regular basis with UK government and Welsh government and colleagues, and we've already had the Northern Ireland executive, which has obviously just been reformed, speaking to us around about what lessons do you need to learn for that. So it's very much a process, a for-government approach process in terms of that learning. So there's discussions going on all the time about lessons from the UK government and Welsh government, what we need to do. So, and it's raised in the ministerial government meetings that we have.
Yeah. Just before you move on, Stephanie, can I bring in Mark Griffin on a brief supplementary?
Thanks, Finn. Just when we were talking about the developer remediation contract discussions, and I brought this up when the officials were here, just to ask how far further down the line are you with discussions with developers, particularly with governments thinking of how they're going to treat SME builders in line with what the UK government are doing down south?
I think that's a really good point. In terms of the SBA process then feeding into the remediation contract, I think that's really important in terms of that. So that process is almost like a dual process. So when we're discussing the SBA process, there are discussions already going on about remediation and how does that SBA process feed through to the remediation contracts, for example. I think when we looked at this, it was almost looking at it in terms of the waves, and obviously it was the larger companies. I've been having discussions with SMEs in terms of that, and I think one of the statements I made right at the start was around about that individual approach. Now, SMEs have that, you know, that we know it's a difficult position for house building at the moment, so there's a balance around about how we discuss with SMEs in terms of making sure that doesn't put their business at risk in a difficult, you know, difficult trading across the UK at the moment. So again, these level of discussions at SME level are being held. What does that look like for the SBA process and in terms of the remediation contracts going forward? On their ability to pay, I think that's really important. So there are discussions in terms of how do we look at that. So, and again, this is down not just in as SME as a sector, but in individual companies. So having discussions with individual companies has been really helpful as well. And I know they've appreciated that because we've had the feedback directly from them around about that specific approach. And we made that really clear when we started out the process with Homes for Scotland, that the SME sector was really, really important, and it wasn't a one-size-fits-all approach. It was very much looking at the sector, the SME sector, as, you know, we need to be, I suppose, more cautious in terms of how we deal with that, but in terms of their own individual circumstances, they're all different. And we've tried to get a balance in about how we take that forward with them. So the approach to the UK PLCs and larger Scottish house builders will be different, obviously, in terms of the SMEs. We need to take cognizance of that, and we're speaking to them very closely, and we'll have continuing discussions with them in terms of the SBA process and how that moves towards a remediation contract. But as I said, I know that's been well appreciated because we've had that direct feedback. But I don't know if Kate and Rachel want to add anything on that at all.
Just to add, as you say, Minister, those discussions are current and they're live at the moment. We're listening to the views of SMEs around ability to pay matters, and obviously, you know, starting from the premise that we seek some sort of contribution from developers, we're obviously seeking to find a proportionate, a balanced response, which is sort of mindful of the particular position of SMEs in the marketplace and consider their role in terms of that wider economy within Scotland and their ability to continue to play an active part in building houses in Scotland at the end of the day. So those discussions are ongoing and we're having regular meetings with them to discuss the particulars of their situation. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks. Stephanie, do you want to come back in?
Yes, please. Mr. Griffin's just picked up on the question that I was kind of going to ask originally there, but just to kind of follow up then, I'm wondering, are you considering making provision for a profit threshold as far as SMEs are concerned, or is that something that's been ruled out or not really on the radar?
I'll bring Kate and Rachel in. Obviously, in the discussions we've had and the approach in the UK government have taken, obviously there's ongoing discussions in terms of that. Some of the things obviously we've been talking to the SMEs about, and SMEs within the Homes for Scotland kind of context as well, as what does that kind of look like. So there are discussions ongoing around about that at the moment. And again, this is really important to them. I'm not just taking, like, okay, the SME sector over there as a one. It's actually speaking to the developers, the individual developers themselves, and saying, okay, where do you sit? Where are you? So it's, even though we're trying to look at a similar approach, it has very much got to be based on what the developers are telling us as well. Now, there's a balance. There's always that balance around, let's remediate the building as quickly as possible. But there's not much a point in doing that if we lose five or six developers because in terms of their ability to pay, in terms of their... So that's been a really important approach. It kind of emphasises the individual discussions we've had, that I've had, and obviously officials have had in terms of that. And as I said to all, the, you know, our doors are open. You know, it's a very much a partnership as we move towards this, and it's a real learn through the pilot programme is what we need to do in terms of that. But Rachel, Kate, I don't know if you want to come in on that particular point about the profit threshold.
So I think that's a good example where we're looking very closely at what's happened in England and in Wales. So in England and in Wales, they both adopted a profit threshold for their main developer remediation contract of profit over 10 million over 3 years. However, in Wales, they've also put in place, in addition to that, a kind of an approach whereby for smaller developers, they also make a contribution. That was just set out in a statement to their parliament back in November time. So we're looking very closely at what has been done elsewhere and how we take the learning from that, but also ensure that it's appropriate to the Scottish market and the Scottish context, and how we ensure that we balance both the need to get value for money for the taxpayer, but whilst also kind of recognising the need to the kind of financial stability of the kind of the market and the individual developers.
I suppose just another point to add, I think, is really important as well, and we've not touched on it so far, as obviously about the building safety levy, in terms of how that then develops over a period of time. Now, obviously, that's not my area of responsibility, but obviously work very closely with the Minister responsible for that and have been involved in discussions, but not led them in terms of the building safety levy. So obviously developers are aware of the building safety levy. Can you come in? We're working really closely with the UK Government colleagues on that, and what does that kind of look like? So again, developers are aware of what that looks like going forward, but I think that's an important context to add to that as well, in terms of that broader, longer-term outlook. I think it's important that that's recognised. But we're working closely with UK Government colleagues in terms of that, but how do we bring in that legislation? And again, there's discussions on already underway with developers who have maybe slightly different people at the meetings, maybe more of the finance kind of stuff. But again, it's, you know, these discussions are ongoing in parallel with what we're doing already as we look towards the building safety levy.
So I suppose just really for clarity, it kind of sounds like, you know, that provision for a profit threshold sounds like a nice, easy, simple solution, but actually maybe the situation is a lot more nuanced than that as well, and it's not as straightforward as it might sound.
I think, again, fair? It's learning lessons, because in down south, you know, you could come and went through the same things. There'll be SMEs that are at certain levels. You know, we all know where the threshold kind of sits with SMEs, where within that threat, you know, where do they sit within that? So again, this is where the really important, yes, having that broader discussions within within Homes for Scotland and SMEs, but it's having the individual ones and learning from them in terms of what does this look like for you, you know, in terms of that. And I think that's a really important part to get to the nuanced position in terms of doing that as we learn from the pilot programme and go forward.
Thanks very much. Thank you, Convener. Thanks, Stephanie. I'm now going to bring in Marie McNair, who's joining us online today.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister and your officials. Over the last few weeks, a number of witnesses have raised concerns about a lack of qualified professionals able to undertake single building assessments in the cladding remediation work. Is that something you share? And if so, how are the Scottish Government likely to address that?
Thanks. And that's a good question. I think the last time I came to the committee, I think in May, if my memory reminds me, at that time, that issue was discussed in terms of that. And obviously, it's part of broader discussions in terms of where are the number of fire safety colleagues in terms of that, not just in terms of just cladding, but obviously broader issues as well. I think there's an issue that faces the UK Government on that, so we are aware of that. Obviously, there are other working groups in terms of looking at building safety where this issue is raised as well. It's not just in terms of cladding and the buildings we have in the register and cladding, but it's beyond that as well, because obviously there's that issue. So it is something we're aware of. We're talking to UK government colleagues in terms of the lessons that they've learnt for that. And again, it's something in terms of the scale of the pilot. What does it, when we move beyond that, what does that kind of look like? But I don't know if Rachel wants to come in on that particular point. I know there have been discussions with fire safety colleagues and representatives of the trade, if you like, in terms of that. But that is something I think that we need to take cognizance of, because if we need to step up the pace, then we need to make sure there's fire safety people there to undertake the assessments that are there. But Rachel, do you want to come in, or Kate, come in on that one?
Yeah, I mean, we've been engaging with others, including RICS, and I think RICS, in their evidence to the committee, also, I think they took the view that they don't, at this point, consider this to be an issue. Obviously, at this stage, we haven't found it to be a barrier in terms of being able to move forward with the programme. But as the Minister said, we will be mindful, and as we said in the evidence session in December, of the importance of ensuring that there is a thriving supply chain from those that are able, for example, to carry out assessments and then follow through in terms of remediation. So I would certainly say it's an ongoing live issue, and one that we continue to engage with the sector and those that would be actually providing those services in due course. So this is obviously part of our ongoing planning for any subsequent national rollout once we move beyond the pilot phase of the work.
Thank you for that. Moving on then to my last question. What funding commitments does the Scottish Government plan to make over the next few years in terms of supporting cladding remediation work?
I think there are a number of things. I think in terms of that, obviously there's very much demand led, and I think that's one of the key things I think that we're kind of looking at in terms of that. So there is that discussion there and about what does that programme look like in the next number of months and in the next year or so. I think we've probably seen the spend in the last number of months is increased as we do more work around about that, and I think that's really important in terms of doing that. I'll get the actual figure that we're looking at that in terms of 24-25, it's £41.3 million this year to try and look at. And as I said, it's very much demand led as we go forward in terms of that. So that cost isn't just in the remediation. Obviously, there's other costs that are involved in that as well. So that's a figure that's been set aside in that regard at the moment. But as I said, it's very much demand led in terms of that. So hopefully, if we quicken the pace, we'll see where that leads us in 24-25. But a substantial increase, obviously, from previous years in terms of that as we get more into the programme.
Thank you for that, Minister. Convener, back to yourself.
Thanks very much, Marie, for those questions. I'm just going to follow up on both of them, actually. Just on the funding commitment, so you said there's going to be £41.3 million building that we went to, and I understand that it's demand-led and that I presume that fund will increase as the demand increases. But we heard a building that we went to see, I think it was about £40 million estimated to just remediate that one building. So I'm just concerned about that number.
Yeah, I mean, again, coming back to them, I mean, obviously that'll be subject to the budget process that we're going through just now. And I think I didn't pick up your first point of the question.
The point, it was just about the funding commitment, and that you pointed out there's £41.3 million, but we visited a building that is estimating about £40 million to remediate it. So I understand from what you said in your previous answer that it's demand-led and there will be more money coming, but that's
you know, that's just at the moment, that would be just an amount for one building. Obviously, different buildings will require different amounts.
Obviously, if we're looking towards the one building, because part of the element, obviously, we've got to try and separate the two. One is orphan buildings, where there are owners in terms of that, and obviously that's where Scottish Government need to pick up in terms of the remediation work that's set out aside for buildings who have the name developer, then obviously they pick that up. So again, we kind of know in terms of the developers we have, but we also know the number of orphan buildings that are set there. Now, there's other expenditure out with that. So, I mean, obviously the remediation of buildings by a named developer, and they've this is where the developer commitment letter and the remediation contracts are incredibly important. It's signing them up to make sure that they do the work that they're planned to do. So, you know, companies have set aside and publicly set aside monies and their accounts to say this is for cladding remediation. So if that's the one building, then obviously the developer should foot that in terms of that. Now, there are obviously issues around about expenditure around about that, but the actual remediation should be by the developer themselves. So we know the issue around about orphan buildings. So yeah, now that's it's a different approach. And we were asked that, we met residents last week in a certain part of Scotland who were talking around about that and saying, look, we're in an orphan building. Where does that sit? Does that put us down the priority list? No. So that's a reassurance we gave them to them at that time, that because it's an orphan building, does that go at the bottom of the queue? It doesn't. But obviously, it's a lot easier in some ways to move forward with a remediation if we know the developers there and they've set aside that sum of money. And they're all in that position, the developers are all in that money. Now, in terms of the SMEs, this is where the importance and nuance discussions are. But in terms of the large-scale developers, they've all set aside a considerable amount of money and publicly set aside the money for the remediation contracts themselves.
Okay, great. Just wanted to make sure we had a reality check on the scale of finance that needs to happen here. And then on the previous question around the lack of qualified professionals, we heard at evidence session that Glasgow Caledonian has a course. It's the only course in Scotland, and it's due to come to an end. And I wonder, I mean, I would be quite concerned about that if we do need to bring on more professionals. And we also heard that what's happening is that because work's moving ahead more quickly in England, that people are going there, you know, people are focusing there. So how do we ensure that we've got enough of a pipeline of people that are going to be able to take on this work? And kind of, you know, we've got this emergency bill in a way. We're taking evidence kind of quickly so it can move forward. But if we don't have the professionals to take it forward, when we're going to run into a problem there.
I think we touched about the ministerial groups that were there previously as well. Obviously, in discussions we've had around about the SBA process and with other bodies in terms of that, I think you've just heard, you know, that's quite confident in terms of that. There's obviously other groups, ministerial groups, for example, on more extensive building safety. In terms of that, now that she obviously is raised within that, and so that, you know, that's, well, I suppose there's a watching eye on that one as things develop. You know, we have the situation, for example, around about RAC, which kind of came out of the blue for everybody a number of months ago, and we had to deal with that situation and obviously dealt with it at that particular point. So there's other ministerial groups that look at the more extensive building safety, I suppose, regime in Scotland in terms of that. So there's always that element of, do we have enough qualified professionals? And there's discussions going in terms of work with colleges and universities in terms of what's required now. But I think in terms of where we are just now, we're comfortable about, you know, what we have in place. And obviously the future demand, because it's not just looking about where we are just now, what's the future demand likely to be, both in here and the rest of the UK as well. But I don't know if, I think, can you touch on it? But Rachel, do you want to touch on that?
And maybe just add to what the Minister and Kate have said, just to give the committee maybe reassurance that this is something that we kind of do talk about. And indeed, we discussed this at the last cladding stakeholder group meeting. And specifically, RICS, who are members of that, talked about some of the measures that they had put in place at a UK level to try and grow the market. So they were certainly expressing a degree of confidence in that discussion. So certainly it is an issue which we have explored, which we will come back to, but which we are regularly keeping under review. So there is no complacency there, but we're not picking that up from that discussion we had in the stakeholder group, that people were flagging this as being a significant issue. It was a concern that was raised by one of the members. Should this be something they should be concerned about? And there was a degree of reassurance given by others around that table.
Okay, thanks very much. I mean, I think we might take this further because maybe we've heard something a little bit different in our evidence session. So maybe we'll highlight that in our report.
I'll come back
Okay, super. I'm now going to bring in Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Good morning to your officials as well. I have a couple of questions which are a bit scattergun, but you can bear with me maybe on this. I just wondered to go back to our previous conversations with regards to other private entities, and whether or not there's been some conversation over them being required to help fund cladding remediation, for example, organisations based on design, manufacture and installation of these cladding systems? Or is that too complicated, really, for this current system?
I'll bring officials in on that one as well. There have been a number of cases. When you look at some of the developers we've spoken to as well, there are sometimes different ownership models. There are sometimes some historical, I suppose, how a company was 30 years ago, how is it developed to where it is now, in terms of that. So that becomes difficult in terms of that. And again, when it comes to some individual discussions, it's, you know, where does a proof of liability kind of own in terms of that? It really becomes kind of hard, I think. And I know there have been some discussions. It becomes really difficult in terms of design standards, which were probably okay at the time, but where does it come now? And it's, I suppose, it's when was the building set out as against when was it actually built, sort of thing. So it becomes really difficult in terms of that. And obviously the scope we're looking at is the last 30 years now. There'll be some buildings that will just be on that 30-year kind of level, sort of thing. But I'll bring maybe in Kate and then Rachel. I know that's kind of been discussed, but it becomes really difficult in terms of, and who takes the action? Is it the companies themselves? Is it government? It becomes really difficult legally, and I don't know if Michaela wants to come in on that one, but Rachel, Kate, in terms of discussions, and maybe Michaela in terms of legal things that have been discussed.
I mean, I'm happy to... I think there's probably... we would see developers as being the kind of the primary kind of people here that we're engaging with, mindful that the developers themselves may well have had professional kind of relationships with people they contracted to deliver the services. I think that's, we would see that probably in the first instance as being a relationship between the developer and those that they contracted to. And so our focus is in relation to the developers. There's obviously UK government separately doing work looking at manufacturers. And they've obviously taken some steps in relation to manufacturing at a UK-wide level. So I think there are different layers to this. There are obviously those elements which are within the competence of the Scottish Parliament, which we are able to progress.
That's helpful. Thank you for that. During the investigations we've been undertaken, there's been some specific issues raised in relation to concerns over EV cars and bikes in the buildings, which will be part of the scheme, and just wondered what discussions are taking place, specifically car parks underneath these developments. There's been quite a drive, quite rightly, to have more EV charging points fitted, but not necessarily any regulations over what that looks like. So just wondered if that's something, as the bill comes forward, will be considered, because I think there were quite serious concerns. And also part of that is factor management around that. And I know that's not specifically part of the bill, but there's various issues over how management will be taken forward around this. So just wondered if that was something which has been picked up and will form part of what's coming.
Yeah, in terms of the broader discussions I'll come back to, I think in terms of the point you mentioned about underground car parks and so on, there have been specific cases of that, where there has to be an action that had to be taken. And when I talked around about before, around about some of the discussions we had to undertake with other stakeholders, we had to get their agreement first before we could do anything about that. Now, part of the legislation gives us ability to go in, if there's a building that's under immediate risk, it gives us ability to go in and undertake that action without, you know, obviously there'll be consultation. But if not, then we've got the powers then to go and do something. Whereas, previously we didn't, you know, until the bill comes out, previously we didn't. Now, when we looked at a previous case that we had to work with, it took a... It happened very quickly, but it did still take a period of consultation in terms of other stakeholders to move things forward. So that, I think that's a really important part of the bill as part of that going forward. It gives us the ability to do that if that's as an immediate risk. So again, we've discussed that with individual buildings. Where the factors come in, I think that's incredibly important as well, because they play a really important role in terms of that. Some of the experiences have been mixed. In terms of that, now that's a broader issue in terms of factors and where residents, some residents have been very supportive of the factors, some haven't been. in terms of that. So again, I think there's that raised awareness in terms of where the factors role is, but also in terms of the broader building safety and talking about fire safety, particularly for underground car parks, for example. And again, this is the part of discussions that Kenny said around about not just about the cladding, but the overall fire safety of a building. Now, there will be regulations around about the fire safety that needs to be picked up. And if we remediate the cladding and there's still that fire safety risk, then there's obviously still an issue there in terms of that. But there's existing kind of legislation around about that. But it's lessons to be learned from that. But we have had live experiences of having to negate and take almost immediate action to make a building safe at that particular time. So there was a learn from it in terms of that. And again, that was really helpful for the other stakeholders, in terms of local authorities, in terms of the fire service themselves. So again, we worked very closely in their key stakeholders going forward. But Rachel, Kate, I don't know if you want to add anything else to that at all?
I think I'd just add, obviously, as part of an SBA process, we'd be looking at those direct and indirect risks which are related to cladding or exacerbated by it. So these could be examples of things which might be exacerbated as a consequence of having cladding there. And obviously the SBA would make recommendations about what you would then need to do in relation to the cladding and how other elements of the building could contribute to that process. Obviously, as the Minister said, we need to be mindful of arrangements in buildings that did not themselves have cladding, and therefore to ensure that there's a sort of level playing field and a consistent approach to wider building safety matters. So I hope that helps.
Yeah, no, that's helpful. Thanks. I've raised previously in sessions in relation to hotels, care homes, student accommodation, where people are sleeping, and wondered with this bill whether or not government are now mindful to include them in this, as they have been in other parts of the United Kingdom, and just wondered what the plans are around these buildings. I think from conversations I've had, student accommodation, a lot of this work is now progressing, actually. But I have specific concerns around hotels and care homes not being included in those over 11 metres. I wondered where government is on that at the minute.
In terms of that, I mean, obviously, the pilot phase was set up was to get main high-risk buildings. And obviously, in terms of the ownership, I think, was one key issue. I think that was an initial thing. Obviously, where you've raised this before, there are some building safety regimes already in place, for example. And we kind of learned the process. I know when we discussed this in May, we didn't have the RAC issue, or the RAC issue was just kind of setting, you know, just coming onto the scene kind of stuff. So there was a look in terms of how safe were our you know, this obviously was focused on RAC, but how safe were schools were. And not to say that there's not ongoing building maintenance carried out in terms of that and identified. So in terms of the schools, in terms of colleges and universities, that was kind of, so there's existing regimes that are in place just now, and I think obviously part of things is in terms of what does that kind of look like. And there's the broader building safety group, which obviously looks at these issues on an ongoing basis, but I don't know if Kate or Rachel want to pick on that, but there's a building safety regime already in place, an established building safety regime in place, but I don't know if Rachel or Kate want to touch on anything else you mentioned.
Obviously in these buildings there is an identified owner in a way that is distinguished from domestic premises, where obviously the freehold and tenure system is such that that ability to then enforce in that respect is not as straightforward, and obviously the bill is aimed to try and overcome the gap that's been identified. So obviously things like schools, obviously it's the responsibility of local authorities and for others, and the same with hotels and care homes. There is a responsible owner that has statutory duties that they need to fulfil in that respect. So I think what we're trying to do is focus the additional effort into areas where there's a gap in arrangements at this point in time, that I'm happy if my colleagues want to add any more to that.
I think the only thing that I would add is obviously we talk quite closely to England and to Wales. Our understanding is in England they gather and publish data on hospitals and care homes and hotels, but they're not formally part of the programme as such. I guess similarly the Minister mentioned the Ministerial Working Group on Fire Safety, which I guess is an overarching mechanism, so health colleagues come to that group and talk about the work that they are doing in terms of remediating their buildings. So I think it is, do we know what is happening in those places? And secondly, do they need to be formally part of the process? And I think it is informally part of the process, as Kate has mentioned. They don't have the same kinds of challenges because they've got a single owner who can take that responsibility on, and we see is doing that.
It's maybe a an area to you know, in reality, these buildings will have almost a version of a night watch in place, but I think specifically around hotels and student accommodation, how that's regulated, what sort of fire evacuation programmes are managed is also another area we need to consider. And I think some of the work going on in England, we maybe need to see how that needs to be replicated up here as well. But it's maybe a wider piece of work beyond this bill, like the factor management aspects we've discussed around these buildings.
Yeah, and,
well.
And I think in terms of the building safety group and fire safety group, in terms of that, there are specific discussions around about that these points to make sure, you know, that the regimes are in place, if you like, the building control system that's in place, and in terms of how they're monitored, and I suppose, you know, in terms of that is really important. So that's kind of picked up within that, and obviously we'll continue to have ongoing discussions with the UK government in terms of what they are doing. As I said, these are ongoing on a number of issues, but it is picked up within building safety and fire safety ministerial groups to make sure that issue is picked up in terms of that. And you know, obviously you learn lessons from RAC in terms of what did that building safety regime look like in terms of that, and how do we make sure that we. And again, RAC kind of came out the blue in a certain way. And again, it's making sure that nothing comes as a surprise, if you like. So there's ongoing discussions around about that on a regular basis.
Thank you. And just finally, in the interests of transparency, would the government look towards the bill, including a requirement for Scottish Government to report regularly on the progress being made on the remediation programme, but also scrutiny, I think, around finances around the bill? Ministers outlined £41 million available, the £97 million in Barnet consequentials, which I think the Scottish Government's got. Be interested, I think, as a committee to know where that's being spent and being reported back to us on.
Yeah, I mean, I'll come back in terms. I mean, I think we've published the figures in terms of the spend, and we'll continue to do so, you know, as that goes forward. And I think we've been open and transparent as possible in terms of that. And obviously, you know, that's something that's. We talked about the split between obviously orphan buildings and remediation for developers. That's commercial confidentiality in terms of that. And again, that's something that could be asked in terms of our own building programme. That's something that we'll continue to publish on an ongoing basis. As part of being in terms of the bill, I'm not. Kelly, I don't know if you want to touch on that at all in terms of where that kind of sits within that. It's not something I'm aware of in terms of that, but it's certainly been open and transparent. We'll continue to be open and transparent going forward around about the spend, which I expect to see a significant increase as we get through the SBA process and into the Cologne Forum contract that we talked about. But Michaela, do you want to add anything on that?
I'll let Rachel come in.
Yes, absolutely. So, Minister, you've said that ministers have previously committed to quarterly publishing data. I think that remains a commitment.
Yeah.
And I think probably we will want to be looking to see what other information we might look to publish. If we look at what England do, for example, there is a regular and proactive publication schedule, and I'm sure there are things we could explore there. I think it would probably be difficult at this point to put that into primary legislation to commit what that would look like, as opposed to the principle of, just as we've done with the quarterly, of looking at what we could proactively put into the public domain that would be helpful to the committee, whilst also seeking to maintain the confidentiality of the buildings. But I think there's a commitment there that to explore that. Sorry, Kate, I don't know if you want to.
No, again, come back to that. You know, we talked about a couple of things we would come back to committee about, and I'm sure there'll be points that you want to come back to us around about after hearing the evidence. In terms of that, you know, if it's maybe outlining some of what your thoughts are in terms of that, obviously we can come back on that particular point through the convener also.
Yeah, that's good. Thanks. Thanks, okay. Convener.
Thanks very much. And this has been such a good session, and it's bringing up more questions. So I'd like to bring Stephanie Callaghan back in.
Thank you, convener. Just the conversation there, my colleague, Mr. Briggs, bringing some stuff up. I mean, the Grenfell tragedy was obviously absolutely a devastating loss of life, and I don't think any of us will ever forget it, and the public were rightly horrified. But I did find it quite reassuring last week. I think it was Jim McGonigal was talking about the fire statistics in Scotland, indicating that we don't have a big problem, that only 1% of fires spread. And that's quite a lot of that's around the really good work that's been done about coverage of fire alarms and other Scottish standards that have been brought in and added on over the years. So absolutely not to minimise the need for this bill or the serious risks around cladding. But I'm wondering if those kind of existing protective measures have been something that residents are aware of and that they understand, and if that provides kind of some reassurance to them as well as this bill moves forward.
I think that's a really good point, because you talked around about the broader fire safety regimes that are out there, ministerial groups, in terms of that, which I think is important. We talked about the fire alarms that, the government kind of brought legislation around, but that the government brought forward. In terms of communications, I think that's certainly something for us to take away in terms of what are your existing, what's already out there. In terms of that, I think would be a good thing to take away and consider in terms of, are you aware of what the regulation should be around about, just the things that you mentioned. And, you know, in terms of the broader work that's carried out by the fire service, isn't just about, you know, they do a lot of work with residents and a lot of work with schools, for example, around about the broader fire safety issues. And I think that's why we see such a low figure in terms of that. So I think certainly think that's something to take away and consult with stakeholders. Is there something we can mention to them about and communications around about that, the broader what's already out there in terms of some of the discussions? Now, what you probably tended to find that when we've had discussions with residents, that there's a raised awareness for obvious reasons around about that. But I don't think there's no harm in looking around about further communication around about that as we go forward. And that's a learn, I think, from the pilot programme, is as we move into a larger scale programme, is what does that look like and what can we do as part of the process right at the start to make sure, look, this is what's already here in terms of that. If you do have an issue, where do you report it to? Is it through the factor? Is it through the developer? Is it through the fire service? Is it through the local authority? So I think there's an element to take away from that and come back to you on.
So just to say, I think that would be really great to hear any further feedback on that as well, because I can imagine as well, I mean, you've spoken about, you know, there's that raised awareness amongst residents, but sometimes there is a vocal group and then there's maybe that kind of more outside group that aren't quite as involved and maybe don't have that full understanding. And I know certainly I can imagine when we went out to visit some of the flats in Edinburgh, had I got the news that there was cladding on my flat, I would have been quite panicked at the thought of that. So it would just be good to know about that a bit more.
I think you're right, because I mean, as you know, I mean, some of the buildings might have 200 or 300 flats. Some of the flats are rented out by people who don't actually, you know, might not come back for a number of years. So, you know, if there's work needing carried out, do we make sure that's there? So, you know, and you'll tend to see a mix of that. You've probably seen it in Edinburgh, I know, in Glasgow, and where I've visited. There's you know, there's people who rent the properties. There's, you know, there's different ownership models, if you like, in terms of that. So, again, picking up that to make sure that we deal with that. In fact, as I've kind of told us, there's some issues around about communicating with people who rent out their buildings, for example. And if there is work needing carried out or small things, then, you know, going through the tenant might be one way, but actually getting to the people who own the buildings is slightly different as well. So we've got to be aware and cognizant of that as well in terms of that broader communication. And again, this is where the communication protocol and how we deal with that is really, really important. So I think there's things for us to take away in that regard, and happy to come back with any thoughts or any feedback you've got on that issue as well.
Great. Look forward to it. Thanks for allowing me back, Convener.
Thanks very much for that. Yeah. So thank you very much for joining us this morning. It's been a very useful, constructive session. I think that we've gotten some clarity on a number of issues there, and we'll certainly highlight some other bits and pieces in our report as well. So, yeah, very much appreciated that you joined us. I'm now going to briefly suspend the meeting to let the Minister and the officials leave.
The next item on our agenda today is to consider the following negative instruments: Non-Domestic Rates Scotland Order 2024 SSI 2024/3, Non-Domestic Rates Levying and Miscellaneous Amendments Scotland Regulations 2024 SSI 2024/4, Non-Domestic Rates Transitional Relief Scotland Regulations 2024 SSI 2024/5, and Council Tax Dwelling and Part Residential Subjects Scotland Amendment Regulations 2024 SSI 2024/10. There are no requirements for the committee to make any recommendations on negative instruments. Do any members have any comments on the instruments? No members have any comments. Is the committee agreed that we do not wish to make any recommendations in relation to the instruments? We are agreed. Thank you. We have previously agreed to take the next three items in private, so as that was the last public item on our agenda today, I now close the public part of the meeting.